Well, today is a very, very good day. You can see my cheeks are a little bit flushed, and that's because I'm so excited. Legendary alpine skier and three-time Olympic medalist Lindsey Vonn is in the house, well, in the virtual house. How are you, Lindsey?
I'm good. How are you?
I am good. I tell you what, it is really amazing to speak to you. And I have to be honest, I kind of can't keep up with you. I don't know where you are and what you're doing because, yes, you're a skiing icon, but you're also a film producer, an author, a motivational speaker. Like, what do you call yourself these days?
I guess I call myself a businesswoman and an entrepreneur. I've been definitely doing a lot. I've been traveling a lot. I think I calculated I was on 14 flights in the last like 25 days. But you know, I really enjoy working hard. I enjoy pushing myself and all of these kind of new ventures or new challenges. And so, you know, I'm trying to keep myself, you know, busy and challenged after my skiing career. And I think I'm doing a pretty good job so far of keeping myself busy.
So let's talk about, I guess, you know, one of the incredible projects that you have been working on. We saw it released just the other day on Olympics.com and on Peacock in the US, Picabo. Your film, you co-directed it. Tell me about what this film means to you, having been able to be such a big part of telling Picabo Street's story.
Well, Picabo has been such a big inspiration to me, you know, pretty much my whole life. I met her when I was 9 years old at an autograph signing, and she's really kind of what inspired me to want to be an Olympian. So to be able to be in this new role, you know, co-producing with Frank Marshall, who's an absolute legend, and producing Picabo's documentary was such an honor. And, you know, I know pretty much everything there is to know about Picabo because I've been, you know, such a fan for a long time. And she had a book that came out right before the 2002 Olympics, which I obviously read. But there's definitely some components to her story that I didn't know. And that I learned through this documentary and, you know, through talking with her and, you know, her ups and downs. And I really think that we were able to make a really great documentary and really share who she is as a person and what drove her and what, you know, obstacles she faced. And she was really such an icon in the 90s and in her time, and just wasn't, you know, wasn't her story wasn't told in its entirety.
What is your, I guess, thoughts and feelings as someone who, and I hope this isn't offensive, but as an outsider now, you're sort of looking in your first Olympics as a retired athlete. How are the thoughts and feelings and emotions about that?
I'm always, you know, going to miss skiing. And so, you know, especially big events like the Olympics where there's high pressure and, you know, the Olympics are just such a unique experience. And I will always miss that. But I'm excited to be on the other side now and cheer on my teammates. You know, I've been mentoring several athletes on the U.S. team and also on for other nations, and I'm excited to watch them, you know, hopefully succeed in their pursuit to getting another Olympic medal in some cases and their first in others. But the Olympics has always, you know, just been something very special in my life, and this will be no different.
What do you like as a spectator?
I mean, as a spectator, you get to see a lot more sports. You know, when I was competing, I really didn't see anything besides alpine. And so, you know, obviously I won't be in Beijing, so I won't be able to see it physically, but I'll really be excited to watch, as I did the Tokyo Olympics last year, but excited to watch really all of the events and you know, be a lot more engaged in the Olympics in its entirety instead of just my events.
Yeah. But do you sort of tear your nails? Are you like my dad? Do you yell at the screen? Like, what is your spectator style? Are you cool and calm?
I'm a pretty vocal spectator. So, you know, I'm going to commentate on a few competitions, and it's going to be difficult for me to contain my emotions because I am very vocal, and I like cheering out loud. You know, I don't know why. Feel like it's more engaging and exciting that way. I try to put myself, you know, in in the competition. So I feel like I'm motivating them from afar, which I'm definitely not, but you know, I feel like I am.
No, but I think that's synonymous with who you are as a person. From what we've seen over all of the years of your competition, is that you have so much passion and you love what you do. Now that you are, I guess, being able to give back to the sport and do things like the mentoring that you're doing, I mean, does your passion for the sport still burn inside you, or do you feel like it's a little bit different now that you're not having to kind of suit up every day?
No, my passion for skiing will never change. You know, I will always miss it. You know, the drive to want to go fast will always be there. You know, unfortunately, I won't be able to ski as fast as I used to. But, you know, I think being able to help others allows me to kind of feel still integrated into the sport in some way. And, you know, to help others succeed and pass down my knowledge, I think is really important, something that's very important to me. But I'm really learning the mountain in a new way now in retirement. You know, I actually went on my first ski vacation since I was 9. And you know, learning to love maybe not going quite as fast, but just enjoying the mountain as a normal skier, not as a racer.
One of your first ski vacations, that's so wild.
Well, I mean, if you think about it, you know, I'm skiing my whole life. The last thing, you know, me and my family are gonna do is go on a vacation to a mountain, because we live in the mountain, so it makes sense. But you know, I have great memories growing up with, you know, skiing with my grandparents and my late grandfather. And you know, I think skiing is such a great family sport that I'm excited to kind of just get back into that aspect of it, you know, away from the competition.
Well, I imagine there are some very excited, anxious, passionate athletes getting ready to compete. Can you give us just a last quick idea of what would be going through an athlete's mind as they prepare to be on this remarkable international stage at the Olympics?
I mean, there's so many things going through an athlete's mind heading into the Olympics. You know, obviously there's a lot of expectation on the favorites. There's a lot of media, you know, there's a lot of, you know, just managing your expectations, managing your energy, you know, managing your excitement. Because sometimes, you know, it's just such an overwhelming level of excitement that it's hard to remember that, you know, you have to focus on it just as it's a normal competition, you know. But I think mainly, you know, they're just going to be excited. I don't think there's a single athlete that's going to the Olympics that's not, you know, over the moon and excited and thankful to be there.
Well, Lindsay, I'm thankful for your time. We're very excited to hear your commentary. Don't be afraid. Don't hold it back. And enjoy the games. Thank you so much for everything you've done for your sport in the past and everything in the future. We look forward to seeing what you do next.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Many of the athletes in the field for this 15K individual. Seconds quicker than Cosmina. Anna Erberg, who has taken out the women's 15K individual from Anastasia Kuzmina, and she's given it everything.